This is a panel discussion called Biting the Hand That Feeds about the relationship between bars and brands and the budgets of brands, their money. Is the relationship broken? Is it fixed? Is it toxic? How is it all around the world? To help us discuss that, coming on stage, we've got an all-star panel, starting with, from Maverick Drinks in London, Mr. Michael Vachon. From both sides of the Atlantic, and from the looks of him, straight out of a washing machine, Mr. Simon Ford. From London, by way of Oslo, Monica Berg. And last but not least, from Eastern Europe, by way of London, Mr. Alex Cretena. So this seminar came about because a few years ago, I realized that on both sides of the Atlantic, nobody knew how it was on the other side when it came to how liquor brands spend their money. In America, where I now live, everyone thinks it's like gym bags full of cash being pushed under the bar and deals being done in back rooms and big, massive drinks companies buying bar managers Ferraris. And in Europe, everyone thinks that that's how it used to be in America and that after Prohibition, it all stopped. So fortunately, that's not the case, and we're going to explore that with the panel here today. So I'd like to introduce them in a little bit more detail. To my right, Michael has founded Maverick Drinks in the UK, which is a craft spirits supplier, a t-shirt manufacturer, and they argue passionately and aggressively against what is the standard way of doing business in the UK, which is that you get retros and kickbacks, which is a fancy word for cash payments, depending on how famous your bar is, how much you sell, how big the drinks company's budget is, and so on. Michael and his company have really changed the amount and type of spirits available for sale,
thank you,
in the UK. So we're very pleased to have him here today. I know he's got a lot of opinions about this particular topic. Hands together for Mr. Michael Vachon.
Thank you, Phil. Thank you, Phil.
For anybody who doesn't know him, to Michael's right is Simon Ford. Simon was a bartender, a wine shop employee, one of the first devotees of Nick Blacknell, who helped invent modern ambassadorship, somebody who helped create many famous brands in the UK back in the days of the Atlantic Bar and Grill, and then got shoveled off to the US, either as a reward or a punishment, still not sure, and several years ago founded the 86 Co., which is a spirits company by bartenders, for bartenders, craft spirits made in fine distilleries. Simon is personally against listing fees because they're wrong and also because his company doesn't have any money. Ladies and gentlemen, Simon Ford.
Hi.
To Simon's right is Monica Berg. Monica is possibly the owner of that unusual accolade, Norway's most famous bartender. She is a multiple award-winning bartender. She has a tremendous place in the world of education because of her knowledge of cuisine and cocktails. Having worked in Oslo, she moved to London, and she has a unique perspective, having lived and worked both under a free market system such as the UK and a Nordic system, which is completely repressed, state monopoly, no advertising, no promotion at all. Dames und Herren, Miss Monica Berg. To her right is Alex Retainer, and Alex used to be a bartender, but now he's unemployed. In fact, what we're going to deal with is that when building the amazing Artesian program, Alex turned the model of cooperating with drinks brands on its head. And instead of asking for money or even allowing them to pay money, he forced them into creative design and liquid collaboration projects that led to the incredible success of the bar and to the incredible drinks and serves that you saw. So he genuinely is the person who has done it and been there and, as usual, is wearing the t-shirt. So, before we kick things off, a bit of history. Brands have always spent money in bars. A friend of mine is Brian Ray, who's 86, who invented the profession of bar consulting. He was teaching cocktail classes, he's a New Yorker, in New Zealand in the 1960s. So if you think you're cool, you haven't met Brian. And he was saying when he was growing up, you could actually open a bar with no cash at all. You'd get money from the cigarette company, you'd get money from the beer company, you'd get money from the person who wanted to run the wardrobe concession, you'd get money from the people who wanted to run the toilet concession. He said it was even easier than it is now. So pause for a moment to let that sink in. When we talk about payments here today, we're normally talking about something called listing fees. Listing fees grew up, as far as anyone knows, in 1960s and 70s, Europe, in supermarkets, in the first mega supermarkets like the French Carrefour chain. Suppliers noticed that if you had six tins of beans instead of just four, you'd sell more. And if they were at eye level, instead of down there or up there, you'd sell more. So they started paying the supermarkets to put them in those positions. And that's still the case today, except it's millions and millions of dollars. It's not unusual to pay listing fees. Now, looking at most of you here, you haven't been to a hairdresser lately. And I've noticed that most of you are not women, which is a shame. But if you go into a hairdresser's, particularly a women's, you'll see like stacks of shampoo and conditioner and dry shampoo and other shite like that. It's not a coincidence that it's there. They're being paid to have it there. And companies like Unilever will also pay a hair salon to stock its products and recommend them, the same way that a drinks company will pay a listing fee for the vodka in your speed rail or the whiskey on your back bar. So I want to kick things off by talking about the Toyota Prius of our panel here, the hybrid, which is Simon Ford. He's been on both sides of the Atlantic. It's not to say that listing fees don't happen elsewhere, but Simon, I'd like you to tell us a little bit about your experience from the wine shop days to bartending and to brand ambassadoring on both sides.
So it is very interesting to note the differences between the USA and the European model when it comes to paying to be in places. And it struck me the very first time I went to the USA that when you would walk into a bar, I was a brand ambassador, I was trying to sell, that I couldn't strike a deal. That made it difficult. You know, going in, I was working for Absolut, and I was working for Ideal Brands, a brand company in London, and we would go into a bar and we would work on a price deal, a pay-to-play deal, and then there would be the POS. We were glass suppliers, we'd give them the fridges. That was how we got a listing in a bar. And then I go to the US and I'm no longer allowed to apply those things. To what Philip said at the very beginning, you used to have a prohibition. When prohibition happened afterwards, it was written by a guy called Rockefeller Jr., a very famous name. He wrote this rule in place. It's called you have to have a three-tier system in the States. Three tiers meant that you cannot sell your alcohol direct to an account. There has to be a distributor. Now, the truth is most distributors in the United States were based on gangsters from prohibition, so they were just basically keeping their business. But of course, it meant it put something in between the brand. And so we can't go to bars in the USA and give them money. There's a limit to the amount. We can't go and give them payola. You know the old days where they would pay record radio stations money? It kind of got banned in the US. And so you're no longer allowed to do that. So of course, what I found out is you have to become really, really creative. And at first I hated it, and now I actually love it. And I'll give you an example. When you walk into Harvey Nichols in London, or Harrods, they both have very famous champagne bars. Last time I looked, the Harvey Nichols bar was the Perrier Jouet champagne bar, and the last time I looked, the Harrods champagne bar was the Veuve Clicquot champagne bar. Now, I don't know about you, but a champagne bar to me, I can buy any fucking champagne I want, right? That's what makes it a great champagne bar. To it be the Perrier Jouet champagne bar has just taken away all of my choice. And now, in my opinion, it's not a very good bar unless I want to drink Perrier Jouet, which I actually do like drinking Perrier Jouet, but I just want to be given a menu of champagne. And so the idea that a brand can go in and just take over an entire account and block everybody out, in my opinion, it's just not progressive. Is the best champagne bar in the world the one that only has one product? No, right? The best champagne bar is the one in the world with an expert that picked all of the best champagnes and they sent their people around to say, this is our favorite, this is my favorite in this style. That's what happens. So pay to play, all of a sudden, stops progression when you are just putting one product at the forefront of a bar or a restaurant. It should be the choice of the expert. The bartender is the expert. They should be choosing the spirits because they are the best spirit for that cocktail. The champagne buyer should be buying the best champagne for that bar. And so, of course, the fact that I used to work for Perrier Jouet and did that deal and got it in place, I was like, yes! We got the bar, you know? It was a win for us. And when I got to the US and I couldn't do that, I found it very difficult. And then I realized over a period of time that because you can't do that legally, it creates much better places. It creates places that pick their brands on the quality of the spirit as opposed to the fact that someone from a marketing department gave them a shit ton of money.
Thanks, Simon. So could I ask more or less the same question of Monica? So Monica, you built your career early on in Norway, which as well as being the richest country in the world per capita, also has one of the most repressive alcohol regimes. And you were in touch with the outside world, you traveled, you knew what was going on. Can you quickly explain how it was to be a bartender trying to make great drinks there and how the relationship was with brands under a state monopoly?
I think the first thing you need to know about Norway is that Norway kind of separates between consumer buying alcohol and bars buying alcohol. So the bar world is very similar to UK, but then your biggest competition will actually be the consumers being able to buy alcohol directly from a state monopoly. And the way that they do it is that they have a very, very high taxation on spirits. So you pay approximately 80 cents, euro cents, per 1% ABV per liter. So let's say for a bottle of Tanqueray gin, you would pay about 24 euros in taxes. And then if you go online, which you can, you see that the government sell the bottle of Tanqueray for 35 euros. And this is the price that you as a bar has to compete with because your prices are different. So it creates this very strong market for drinking at home and drinking in your with your friends before you go to the bars. So the bars have a very difficult way of getting people to come out earlier because it's a question of money. Also, it creates this kind of disconnect because brands can legally not talk to consumers. So let's say you as a brand want to go to Norway and launch your gin, you can do it, but you cannot tell anyone. You could actually tell the bartenders, but unless they like your product, they won't tell anyone. So it kind of becomes this very relationship where everyone is very dependent on each other and you kind of have to find a way to coexist because otherwise the home market is just gonna eat away everything else. So for me, when I moved out of Norway, I found it very confusing because the restrictions that we have in Norway, they sometimes are good because it makes you very creative and you have to work very hard to get people to come out, and otherwise it's very freeing to be somewhere you can say, oh, I can have anything. So yeah.
Is there any advantage to that? Does it create a level playing field? If nobody can talk to the consumer, does it create a playing field between mega brand X and tiny brand Y? Or does it not work that way?
I would say yes and no. It becomes very, very dependent on personal relationships. So if a big brand has a good relationship with the bars, you will see that they are instantly, you can see it in the statistics, that they sell more. Whereas if a small brand has the same good relationship, it also will be able to read it from the listings. But it doesn't always come from money. Sometimes it's just about being a nice person.
But if they have three brand ambassadors and your little brand has one, I mean, how can brands influence sales?
Also, we don't have brand ambassadors in Norway.
Okay.
So, yeah. No, Norway is not a big market, so they have sales forces / brand ambassadors, and you have Nordic brand ambassadors that pop in like every 3 months or so, but there's really much more based on the relationship with the local people from the brand, so they kind of have these multi-tasking roles, which also sometimes creates a little bit of issues, because a lot of the people working for the brands in Norway, they have a finance background, but the only time they've ever spent time in bars is when they were studying and chugging beers and free shots, so it kind of, yeah, creates a few issues.
Okay. Thanks. So same question for Michael. Michael, I know you have your roots in America. You came to the UK. That must have been pretty interesting.
Yeah, I mean, I've only worked in drinks for about 4 years. So when I joined, I come in with a huge dose of naivety. I came into a bar and I brought some products from the US and I thought, I've got something great here. I've got a great, delicious product that everyone's going to want to buy. So I walked into bars and bars said, we do. We love this. In fact, we're going to put it in our new menu. We're going to use it in our House Manhattan. And I thought, this is too easy. All you need is a great product and everybody will want it. And then you sell it to them and that's how it works. And then the inevitable question, how much can you support? I said, well, what do you mean support? I'll come in here. I'll do a tasting, training. No, I mean, how much can you pay us to use the product? And I just thought, well, that's funny. I went to all this trouble to bring the product here, and now I'm having to go pay people to use it. So, I mean, and when I started, everybody in this panel probably each had at least 10 years under their belt. So there is definitely a high degree of naivety here, but I just couldn't believe that. And so we took a stance quite early on because we couldn't afford to. By necessity, it was just me. I didn't have the cash to pay people to use the product, so I moved on to the next bar and on to the next bar. So really, the fact that I didn't pay for listing fees was really born out of necessity than anything else. And people want to try and turn this into a big brand versus small brand debate all the time. They say, well, big brands have the money. They can pay the listing fees. Well, too bad, small brands. Too bad for you. You got to sit by the sidelines. And it really isn't about small versus big. The big brands I speak to say, shit, I wish we didn't have to pay £30,000 to be on that menu. But, that's how the system works. That's the game. And so we made a stance quite early on. We made T-shirts that said, fuck retros, fuck kickbacks, drink craft. And people thought we were doing it just to be small guys, be ballsy. But it wasn't about that. It was about, back to what you say, Simon, it was all about bartender choice. And we wanted to at least have bartenders to have the option to use the things that they'd like to use. And a lot of the contracts we say, or that we've seen, prevent them, or at least say their menu has to be dictated 70%, 80% of the menu must be X. And very few bars that we work with have been able to overcome that and use the brands that they want to use. So the system has become a barrier to innovation in a lot of ways, and it has limited choice. And that's been my experience.
Well, we're going to get somebody who's all about innovation, Alex, in a moment. Alex has plenty of time these days to do stuff. all day. But first, show me the money. How much are we talking about here? What's the kind of money you hear bandied around in London, right? What kind of listing fees are banging around there?
You know, some of the more prestige bars, you could be talking in the tens of thousands of pounds for many listings. Per brand, per house pour. I mean, I've heard numbers that would scare you. I mean, 25, 30
them.
Grand.
Yeah.
I know bars that have, and bars brag about it. I mean, I talk to bars and they're saying, you're never going to believe how much money we got at Diageo last week. And next month we're doing contracts with Pernod. Can't wait. We're going to be all day long. So, I mean, we're talking 30, 40,000 pounds in some cases as a starting point for listing for house pour listing fees. I had one bar come to us and say, and this is a bar that is recently ranked in the top 10 in the world. And they came to me and they said, we love your products. We think what you're bringing to market is genuinely different. We want to use them on our menu, but all we need is 600 pounds per cocktail. And I said, okay, well, we're not going to do that. We're not going to give you any of the money. I know 600 pounds isn't a lot of money, but we're not going to do that because we don't do that. But here's what we'll do. We'll host four times a year. We'll host an event at your bar. You can sell tickets. We'll bring the stock on a slow night, and you can just have those ticket sales. And if you charge 20 pounds and we'll bring five gins, the customers get a great tasting for 20 pounds. They probably stay on, pay more. And they've already made that money in one or two events easily. All they're doing is turning the lights on and putting some glasses out. Now, they turned that down. And I said, OK, well, let's think a little bit more creatively. What if we gave you 6 months credit terms? So we'll give you the stock. You don't pay a penny for it for 6 months. Right, but how does that help me now? Well, you know, I don't have time to go into a whole business discussion about cash now versus cash in 6 months. But trust me, not paying for this in 6 months is worth a lot more than 600 pounds today. And they said, well, we really need the 600 pounds. I said, okay, well, geez, I'm trying to think outside the box here. But they were so conditioned that if you're not getting the listing fee, then there's really no point. And they said, well, we really need that 600 to open. And I thought, if 10 cocktails on your menu, 6 grand is the difference between you opening and not opening, don't open. I mean, you're on a knife edge there, if that's the case. And I think I don't think that they needed that 6 grand to open. I think that they just thought, that's the way things are done. So why shouldn't we have our piece of the cake as well?
Oh, very true.
Can I make a point?
Well, Simon, I wanted to briefly get to you before Alex, in fact, because in the US, you and I both live there. You're not supposed to do any of this, but of course they do! Like, Simon brought it up. You know, it's really true that during Prohibition, all the alcohol was being sold by gangsters, right? You know that. Do you think they just quit when it ended? No, they did. They formed limited companies, right? I'm not joking, and I'm also not being mean, but it's the basis of the alcohol distribution industry in the USA. So you and I know, in the US, it does happen. Big brands, can you talk to that and name a few numbers?
Yeah, pay-to-play does exist in the US. Obviously, I painted a picture that it doesn't, and it just happens in a creative way. But what you can't do is create a deal, because, of course, what you're essentially doing is illegal. So you have to have trust. If you went and figured out a way of giving 5 grand for a menu placement and they didn't put your product on the menu, you couldn't go to an authority or like go, hey, he didn't put my product on his menu and I gave him 5 grand. There's nothing you can do because you'd be basically going, I just did something illegal. So, but you do make deals and they're sort of gentleman's handshake deals. It's like, if you put my brand on your list, I will come and I will spend 5 grand a week for the rest of the year. So I have known of a deal where $10,000 was promised for a Sunday brunch every month to an account, and they would go in and spend 10 grand. And it's actually pretty cool. That brand goes in, spends 10 grand, and brings other bartenders, and they have a good time. But they basically committed $120,000 to an account in spends to get the deal. So there are ways around it. Now, America's a vastly complicated place. There's 50 states that have different rules in every single state. That's another thing that happened after Prohibition. Miami, Vegas, two pretty corrupt places. You can pay to play in those cities. And Washington, D.C., the capital of the United States, they don't really have a democracy there. So you can do whatever you want there as well. But then there are other places. If you look at New York, which is one of the most, if you're ever thinking of launching a brand in the U.S., New York's the place you want to go to first, because there are listing fees. You have to, what I mean by listing fees is you have to list your price. So everybody can see everybody else's price, and you're not allowed to sell to anybody a price that isn't listed. So you have this competitive landscape that everyone can see. Whereas if you went to Chicago, the list price is just a fake front number that you tell people, because everything is going to be done on a price deal behind the scenes. And so you can do price deals. So there are lots of creative ways. You just have to have a vast encyclopedia of the lore in your head to get around the system. I mean, the truth of the matter is, and I want to come back to the point, is it was really weird bringing some of my good bartender friends to Europe. But we would walk into a bar, and every drink on the list was made with one gin. And they couldn't believe that a bar would be considered creative if every, it was like the gin page. And if you go to the gin page in a good bar, you would be like, there's five with this gin and two with that gin and one with this gin, because all gins are different. A bartender makes cocktails to the gin, but then of course the bar that took the listing fee, all the same gin. And like, that's not cool, that's not creative, that's not showing that you're the best cocktail bar in the world, you can only work with one gin. What did you do? Go, and then the next month you go in and it got listing fees from somebody else, and then that gin, the same cocktails, probably the same specs, so, you know, another gin. It's not cool again, you know. The cool bars are actually putting in products because that product worked in that drink, and that's creativity. So taking listing fees, in my opinion, thwarts creativity if you are just going to stock one product, right? What you should be thinking is, yeah, you know, next month I'm going to be doing a drink with Ocho because I found this flavor that I think would go so well with that tequila, you know? But then that drink might not last for 3 or 4 months. You'd be like, but I'm changing the new menu, the full menu, and I've got this great drink and it works so well with Fortaleza. There are no listing fees here. They're two brilliant tequilas, and they are basically got a creative bartender making drinks that suit that drink. But as soon as you take a listing fee just to do one product, then I don't know how you could be one of the best bars in the world personally. I don't know how that works in my head.
Well, speaking of that, moving on to Alex. Alex has built the world's best bar, but also the way that you worked with brands was very different, Alex. I know when you moved to London and you learned how it went, in a way you rejected it. You created a new way to collaborate with drinks cultures. Can you talk about how you started and how you developed that idea?
Well, kind of first thing I want to say, and I was very happy that Simon mentioned this, like, unfair European advantage. I read Robert Simonson's book where Neren Young, you know, complains a lot how much money we have in Europe. Like, I know a lot of people in US who, you know, run events that never happen, getting paid for that. They don't even go to the branches you organize. They, you know, they just pay and swipe credit card for 5,000. You know, they print menus and materials that never been printed. So it's like, it's not really fair to say to us Europeans that, you know, it's not happening. It is happening. So either you are nice or you are not creative enough. Because I know a lot of strip clubs in US who, you know, curate lounges with alcohol brands. So I think the first question is actually, what do you do with the money? Do I think the system is broken or the culture is toxic? Yes, I do think that. And we've been all part of creating it, and that's why we need to have this sort of chat. Now the question is, the money is there, it's happening. It's about what you're doing with the money. And I think that if you run an event which never happened and still getting paid for that, logically, most people put them into bottom line and not actually into, you know, like a creating something. So the way how we approach it as a bartenders was like, everything is negotiable. It's a business. If you don't ask, you don't get. You know, so the overall aim you need to have as a bartender is to have a balanced menu, because famous menus with only one gin brand suck. And it's not cosmetics, it's not shampoos. You know, I think cocktails are perceived in so much more like a culinary art than shampoos, and that's why we need to have the balanced menus. The reason why we went that way was very simple. I used to work for this shit hotel company, which didn't give me budget for basic glassware. So many times I found myself in the situation where I didn't have budget for my own glassware. During my time at Artisan, I spent over £10,000, and I can prove it with the receipts, of me buying glassware, highballs or rocks, because I was embarrassed to have all the international people coming and not having a glassware. So we said, well, let's do a glassware which you cannot break. And boom, here it started. You know, so my main thing was how to limit the breakages, really, at the beginning. Then we said, let's do something fun, because we've seen a lot of places, nightclubs and other hotel bars were taking money, but they were putting it to the bottom line. So we went to the company, it was like, hey, don't you want to do something cool? So like, do you want to create a unique POS, which is, you know, only for yourselves? And this is, you know, how it really, really gets started. But still, I believe, you know, it's about relationships. So to kind of sum it up, I wanted to run through the typical things which are on the contracts with most companies, if that's okay. No. So a typical liquor company, no matter size, big or small, is going to put in the contract something called trading status, and that basically tells how much they're going to pay you for each of their brands to, you know, what's the status going to be. So it's going to be the cocktails, which means you need to list it in the cocktails. They're going to put it in a pouring. So they're going to ask you if general call is made, you're going to pour that. Then 3 months later, they give you a training on upselling. So they're completely working against themselves. Or they're going to give you must stock, which you can buy one bottle per year. And then you buy it, and then you have it there for a year. So most of the contracts are done for a year. On the top of that, as a bar, you're going to get in UK something called annual retrospective, which is literally a rate per case, 9-liter case, because we are in Europe, and that's going to be for a prestigious account between £30 to £50 per case. Marketing support, that's really literally means like marketing can be anything, so as long as you can create a strong narrative, the brands will buy it, because then they have to spend the time creating the narrative themselves. And that's going to be really based on your visibility. If you're doing cool things, if you know you're getting press, that's when you can really say 10, 20, 30,000 pounds. And then it's the PR drive. A lot of the companies will tell you that they're going to drive your PR internationally, nationally, or online, and they're going to put a price on that. Then you're going to have money. You see, the contracts are really long. So as a bartender, it's a kind of like a new thing. Then you have money for bar equipment, which is hardware, POS, but it can also be items from your CAPEX, the capital expenditure. On the top of that, you get brand trips, staff training, which you know they're going to put some ridiculous amount of money. And then you're going to deal with them if you're doing collaborations with things like intellectual property. So as a bar, you know, I really think that it's only about how you negotiate. Do I think it's toxic? Yes, it is wrong. Yes. Does it work for the brands? No, long term, no way. Does it work for the bars long term? I don't think so. But we have a system in a place where operators, hotels, and you know big chains got used to have those money. So my challenge annually would be, one of my duties while doing all the contracts, how much money actually I'm bringing to the company. Because the company I used to work for expected me to deliver all of these things. So as a bartender, you are sort of middle, and you're trying to find out what is the best way and how you're going to make it, you know, to work for yourself. I didn't feel it was disruptive. I felt it was just really standing up and being a bartender, like, don't tell me what to do. Don't throw contracts at me, which I don't understand. Let me tell you how we're going to work. And I think that's generally the approach we need to take. What I also want to highlight, these contracts, they are not important only with the big companies, but you can work very cleverly with the small companies, because a lot of small companies can provide you with things the big one doesn't even know about. So whether it's a special extract or a beaver gland you get, you know, people can help you. And then you give back something else. So I always see it as a collaboration and relationship. The difference between alcohol brands and your other suppliers is that alcohol brands, most of them, and I can tell you now because I quit Artisan, And most of the people kind of don't give a fuck about me anymore, and I take that, because they only deal with you when you're working in an account that is hot. Your fruit and vegetable guy is creating a relationship with you, like with the chefs, because they know that maybe he doesn't have a bar for 3 years, but he's going to have bar again, you know, in 5 years. So it's always, to me, I think about creating a relationship, you know, and I think that liquor brands can learn a lot about that. You know, it's not about throwing money, but creating relationships. That's what I think about that.
Well, Alex, just before we pass on, Michael's got a point to make. But one of the things that you and the team did at Artesian, you functioned almost like a creative agency. You would create these amazing serves, some of which became global POS items for mega brands. So you performed a function that, you know, if they paid £30,000 for it, they would have paid far more to an agency of hipsters to create. So do you think that was like how the added value was justified?
And this is where you again need to become a businessman. So you need to think about it. Our lawyer told us long time ago, you always prepare for failure, but also you need to prepare for the success. So in that contract, that's what I said about you just don't accept contract what somebody tells you, but you add clauses to the contract, or you make the contracts yourself. And that's where you need to go. Intellectual property is either owned by the studio that developed it, by the bartender who came up with the idea, or et cetera. So these are important things as a bartender you need to have in the contract. So if there's such an intention as starting to use it as a global POS, you get rewarded and you have a separate conversation on that.
Great. Michael's got a comment he wants to bring up on Alex's point.
I was just going to say, Alex, so, you know, we talk about, again, being big brands versus small brands and not being about that. Relationships is key. And what you delivered in terms of value to some of those big brands is incredibly worthwhile. I mean, this is huge money, like you say. And I'll never forget that in 4 years of Maverick Drinks, we've done one deal. And that was, you called me in and you said, Michael, listen, I love your products. I want to use some of them. I have owners who I am culpable to, that I am responsible for delivering something of substance in terms of a deal. And if you work with me, we'll find a way to make this work. And it's about those relationships. So we did one deal for 1 year. The contract was probably one line. Yes, we'll give you one bottle for every 12 you pour. And on the back of it, you said, you know, and also 7 of your other products we're going to use regularly whenever we can use them in cocktails because we love them. And if more bars came to us like that, with that approach, we'd probably do a lot more deals because it actually delivered value for both people. But now most people we work with, it's just an expectation.
If you allow me, I think that is how money should exchange hands between a brand and a bartender. There is money there, and there are brands that need to be sold. And it's not going to go away. Just handing over cash or giving the cheapest price is a false economy. And also, every time you give it to one account and you're not giving it to another account, it's kind of unfair. And people talk. Believe me, I was talking to just a bartender just before the seminar that said, my friends in New York are getting this giant deal, and I sell twice as much of that product. You know? They're screwing me because I'm not in New York, right? Because it's London that always gets the money, or it's the main cities that always get all of the money. The future shouldn't be about giving money. It should be about creative collaboration between the bartender and the brand. There are so many ways that a brand could work with a bartender. Create a new vessel of glassware or something to serve the drink in. Work on a product that could be served in that cocktail. It could be just something as simple as setting up a bar, which I know Bacardi did for the White Lion at Heathrow Airport. That actually serves as a purpose for both the consumer to learn about cocktails, to learn about their brand, and for the White Lion to get their name out there. There are ways that you can work together that are creative. The money can still exchange hands, but it's just like, here's some cash. That's kind of selling your soul to the devil, in my opinion. But if you start using that to be creative and push our industry forward, then that is actually a journey that could really, really happen. Because think about this for a second. If your favorite gin in a Bramble is brand X, but your second favorite or your third favorite gin offers you money, you still gave your customer your second best or your third best. You didn't give them the best, right? And that's you, because of money, not giving the best you could possibly give to your customer. You should give them the best that you feel is the best. And if you get money from it, great, but you should give them always the best regardless.
So just before I forget it, which happens more and more often around this time every day, in terms of negotiating, there's one book you should all read. Write it down now. If you ask me later, I'm not going to tell you. This is your chance. It's called Getting More by Stuart Diamond. It's the best book ever written on negotiating. It will change every contract you ever negotiate on. Now, back to the seminar, what Simon mentioned and Alex as well. There is a very creative way to work on this. I'll give you an example. There's a famous American bartender. In fact, he won American Bartender of the Year, Sean Kenyon in Colorado. And every year, all the staff get to go on an international trip. And what they do is they visit one or more distilleries. They go to Scotland or the Caribbean or England, which is amazing. Right, for any American, but especially if you're from Colorado. If you understand Colorado, you'll get that joke. And how do they do it? Well, at the start of the year, they sit down with the brands and they say, all right, well, we want to do a trip. We want to do a trip to Cognac. We want to do a trip to London. We want to do a trip to wherever. How much do we have to sell to hit that target from this brand or your whole portfolio, which is a very honest way to do it, and certainly in the US, it's a more legally acceptable way to do it. But moving on, Monica, since you moved out of full-time bartending, you've worked with several Aquavit brands, you work with Himcock, they've kind of taken you in, as it were, and that's also a way of working with bartenders, as I see it. And they've given you sort of options, you've become somebody who distills. How do you feel about partnerships like that as the future of collaborations?
Personally, I believe in it very much. I've always been a very big fan of education and knowledge more than anything. So I always used to, even when I was running bars back in Oslo, or London for that matter, I always used to ask my brand reps for either tastings, seminars, or trips for my staff more than me, because I've been on trips. And I think like giving someone the knowledge about distilling as a brand, I think that is probably the best gift you can give as a spirits brand, because one thing is to understand what happens during the process, but another thing, and trust me on this, like when you are making the cuts and running the still by yourself, you just go, holy shit. And you're just like, wow, and it's amazing. And I really believe that this is should be used much more.
I think generally, if I speak for all the bartenders in the room, if brands help us to become better on both personal and professional level, that's when you create a relationship and you perhaps become loyal for so much longer than when you are at that hot account. And you see generally as a trend, I think, amongst companies, because now you have companies who sell sneakers, but they don't actually market you sneakers. They just help you to get more healthy, have a better running plan, have a better diet, you know? So I think that's really interesting to me. And if somebody helps me to grow, for sure, I will never forget.
I think it's important to talk a little bit more on numbers. I'll give a personal example. I opened Door 74 in Amsterdam in 2008. And by that stage, I trained almost all the sales staff of all the drinks companies in Holland. And they came in, and one of them offered me a deal. It was like $10,000, euros obviously back then, same thing now, $10,000, 10,000 pounds, for a whiskey brand, which, like Simon said, it was probably my second favorite whiskey. I'm like, oh, that would be totally cool. You know, I will totally take the money for my second favorite whiskey. But they said, oh, and you've also got to take this and this and this and this and this and this and this, all the other things from their portfolio. And I'm like, dude, I know the money's coming from the whiskey brand. You're just trying to shovel these things in. And for Europeans, there's another important consideration. Everyone here, except anyone who lives in England, is part of Europe. And you can buy your products from anybody. You can buy it from a third party parallel import company. But if you do a deal with a brand, you're going to have to buy it from the official distributor, and that will be quite a bit more expensive, potentially, than a third-party distributor. So I looked at that 10 grand deal. I looked at how much it cost me to buy that whiskey from a parallel importer, because the bar was in Holland. And then I thought about all the other shit I would have to do. They wanted to have like bottles on the back bar in a row. They wanted me to take this other rubbish. And I worked out that I'd be selling my soul for 80 euros a week. It's not really worth it if you run the math, right? So please read that book in negotiating, but also run the mathematics and see if you're going to sell your soul, fuck it, sell your soul, right? But make sure you get a good price, I feel, for you and for your staff. So the question to round up with, we might have a question or two from the audience if we finish up, is where does it go? Let's do this like the American presidential debate. Everybody gets 2 minutes. So Michael, 2 minutes. Where does it go from here? What's the future?
So we knew that we couldn't get around, at least initially, we couldn't get around people getting listing fees and asking for that and working that into their cost structure. So we tried to change the cost structure. So we looked at how they can reduce their costs, how they can sell higher price cocktails at a lower percent margin and actually make more cash on those cocktails. So we're actually trying to take a step back from all of this and say, let's educate on the business fundamentals first, get that right, and then we can look at why listing fees don't make sense. So we are fighting the good fight, but obviously I think we've still got a long way to go.
Business training for bars.
That's one way.
Excellent. Mr. Ford?
I mentioned it before, but the future for me is definitely creative collaboration with brands. Instead of taking money and putting a false economy on the price of a drink, actually spending the right amount of money on that spirit and selling that spirit for the price that it's supposed to be to the consumer, but instead using the money and the financial structure of brands to build your brand as a bar or build creative collaborations. It could be glassware, it could be pop-up bars around the world. But for me, that's the relationship between the brand. But the number one thing is to always choose the product that is the best. That's what you should be doing. If you get some money for it, great. But if you do it for the money, then it's not so great.
So I think it's about just sitting down and having a conversation and be generous. It's always something I like to say, be generous, whether it's with your time or your money or your creativity, and just talk to each other, because so many times we hide behind the emails, and bartenders normally do not prefer email, we prefer talking. So it's much easier just to be in the same room, have a conversation. What do you need? What do you want? How can I help you? If you start with this three questions, both sides, I think we could move quite much further.
I think we should build a wall and keep the enemies out. No. I think that the stage we got into, we are now in an age where pay to play, there's only very few brands who can actually pay it. And even for them, I'm like, guys, this is not long-term viable. You won't realize it. Nobody's realizing it because the brand managers and all the top management, they come and go so quickly that nobody's actually realizing that long-term it doesn't make sense, right? But as a bartender, I hope with what we're doing here, with amazing conventions like this, with all the stuff that's coming out also from bartenders for bartenders, you know, the future is going to be bright. We're going to collaborate collectively, but in the first place, we're going to be putting ingredients into our cocktails because they are delicious, they taste great, and that's how we feel. So go out there and express yourself.
Okay, let's all pretend that this is still a democracy. We either have time for one question, or we can all go to the bar. Hands up for one question. Thank you very much, ladies and gentlemen, Alex Retena, Monica Berg, Simon Ford, and Michael Vachon. Thank you, Mixology and BCB. See you tomorrow.